Thank you very much, and good morning to all of you, especially to our foreign guests. Mabuhay, magandang umaga sa inyo. I would like to acknowledge the presence of Ambassador Cecil Ramon of the Department of Foreign Affairs. Thank you, Assistant Secretary and Acting Vice Chair of the Climate Change Commission, my favorite government agency because I gave birth to that, Joy Coco. And Assistant Secretary Gary Domingo of the Department of Foreign Affairs, and Undersecretary Alex Kama, who is in the midst of all the coordination for disaster risk reduction of the OCD, which is the Secretariat for the National Disaster Risk Reduction Management Council, another law that we authored. So imagine if the Senate or Congress did not author these laws, who would be negotiating in Paris? Who would be negotiating in Bonn? Who would be hosting this conference for you? Who would be coordinating all the impacts of Yolanda and Lando and all of these agencies? So we're proud that we have actually put in place all these policies, all these commissions and councils. What we need to do is to strengthen it. I'm happy to meet the new UNDP resident coordinator, Mr. Ola Ongren. I hope I pronounced your name correctly. And all our friends, I believe that everybody present here is both a climate change adaptation and mitigation advocate and a disaster risk reduction advocate, if not policymaker, if not implementer. So, welcome. In fact, I shouldn't be speaking before you because you are the experts, you are the scientists, you are the technicians who should probably tell me more about the work you're doing in your respective countries, but I'm honored and humbled to be before you today. Commissioner Sammy Alvarez, who is one of the first in my country to be able to convey the importance of climate change when he was still in the Senate more than two decades ago, and his wife, Cecile Alvarez. It is therefore with pleasure that I welcome you to the Philippines for the third global meeting of the Climate Vulnerable Forum. Just an aside, in 2009, when I was on a UN mission because I worked with the UNISDR, and we met with then President of Maldives, Nasheed, I brought up the idea, along with Jerry Velasquez of the ISDR and Manny de Guzman was a consultant then, that Nasheed and I set up the Climate Vulnerable Forum. I even gave President Nasheed a copy of a concept note that UNISDR and I, my office then, heading the Climate Change Committee, that we could probably start out with the Maldives and the Philippines. I believe that I also gave a copy to then Timor-Leste President, Jose Ramos Horta, and he said, maybe between the two of us, we can have some group. I did not call it yet a forum. We call it a climate countries which are vulnerable to climate, etc. And I'm happy to see that the concept note that we gave President Nasheed of Maldives had reached the UNDP and had eventually been formalized as the Climate Vulnerable Forum. I'm not saying I'm the author of this. All I'm saying is that, call it serendipity or synchronicity, and we are here holding the third global meeting of the Climate Vulnerable Forum. I believe that we are here today not to discuss the theoretical merits of doing something versus doing nothing about the climate crisis. The signs are all around us. The numbers speak for themselves. It is no longer an issue of taking action, but rather of how much action we need to take. As you all know, 3 weeks ago, Typhoon Kwapu, Lando, battered provinces in Luzon, here in the Philippines, affecting more than 3 million people, causing damages to agriculture and infrastructure worth $235.8 million or 11 billion pesos. This, as several communities in the Visayas, particularly in Tacloban, have yet to fully recover 2 years after Super Typhoon Haiyan or Yolanda, which celebrated its anniversary, maybe not celebrate, which commemorated its anniversary, I correct myself, yesterday, as it wreaked havoc in the region, killing more than 7,000 individuals on November 8th of 2013. And in between that, Yolanda and Lando, we had Sendong and Pablo and Habagat and many others. And as I speak before you, we also have El Nino, as you know, which will run out to the first quarter of 2016. So clearly, we must take urgent and aggressive climate action. The Philippines and fellow member nations in the Climate Vulnerable Forum can no longer take this injustice sitting down. This gathering in Manila is historic because first, I believe that you will be signing the Manila-Paris Declaration, which articulates the common aspirations of the world's most vulnerable countries for the UN Climate Change Conference that will be convened end of this month towards the first week of December. Second, we're all here to agree and to finalize the Climate Vulnerable Forum Roadmap 2016 to 2018, which contains the medium-term climate action agenda of our vulnerable countries. I just wonder, why is it just 2 years? Perhaps you could have 2016 to 2020? Because before we have a roadmap, knowing legislation, knowing how policies are set out, before you get to actually implement it, it will be gone. So just suggestion 2016 to 2020 perhaps, but it's really up to you. In crafting these documents, we have to be ambitious, as you all would agree. We must no longer plead for the rest of the developed nations to commit and to act upon the decades-long stagnation to limit global warming to less than 2 degrees Celsius. Today, we demand that the world join us and do something to reach a target of 1.5 degrees Celsius to prevent any further risks to present and future generations. The average global temperature has risen by 0.8 degrees Celsius since 1880. At this level, we are already experiencing unprecedented extreme weather events, whether it's severe droughts, frequent, more intense, stronger typhoons, sea level rise, floods, landslides, etc., among many other climate change impacts. The United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, or the UNFCCC, has received 154, if I'm not mistaken, INDCs. But these submissions are inadequate, as the combined commitments as computed now would still lead to 2.7 degrees Celsius global warming by 2030. As you all know, perhaps, the World Bank projects that under a 2 degrees Celsius scenario, there will be a 20% decline in water availability for many regions and a 15 to 20% decrease in crop yield. So if it's this, with our commitments, it's 2.7, and a 2.7 would spell devastation, destruction, loss, and damage to livelihoods, and even death. We've reached almost 1%. So clearly, the INDCs must even be made more ambitious, and negotiations must be tougher. With a warming of up to 2 degrees Celsius, sea level rise is projected to be 70 centimeters. Sea level rise, floods that damage fish farms, and the increased acidification of the oceans by 2050 could reduce farmed fish yield by 90%. And if we reach a 4 degrees Celsius warming, the IPCC predicts, and I quote, severe and widespread impacts on unique and threatened systems, substantial species extinction, large risks to global and regional food security, and the combination of high temperature and humidity compromising normal human activities. That's in the words of the IPCC. So clearly we need to limit warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius to be able to survive. We are in a position to demand it because as developing nations who are the least emitters of carbon, we bear the brunt of climate change. The Philippines is 0.002 degrees, as in joy or red, is that accurate? But we are much less than 1%. Yet we are the third most vulnerable nation in the world, and as far back as 2009, Typhoon Ketsana or Indoy ate up 2.5% of our GDP, which could have gone to schools, to education, to teacher training, to hospitals, to healthcare, to building homes. A study by DARA, commissioned by the Climate Vulnerable Forum, entitled Climate Vulnerability Monitor, a guide to the cold calculus of a hot planet shows that if the world goes business as usual, there will be 6 million deaths per year by 2030, close to 700,000 of which will be due to climate change. The report further states, and I quote, that a significant share of the global population would be directly affected by inaction on climate change. The global figures mask enormous costs that will, in particular, hit developing countries and above all the world's poorest groups, unquote. Least developed countries face an average of more than 7% of foregone GDP in 2010 due to climate change and the carbon economy. Over 90% of mortality assessed in the report occurs in developing countries only, more than 98% in the case of climate change. Of all these losses, it is us, the lower and middle income countries, that are most exposed. Our losses of income are already extreme, and our development goals, particularly on poverty reduction, will be harder to achieve because of the climate crisis we're all experiencing. Within our respective economies and among us vulnerable nations, we must adapt. We must also mitigate, even if we are non-emitters. We need to strengthen the capacities of our governments and apply the whole of society approach in integrating responses to climate change within national to local policy frameworks and programs of actions. I take humble pride in the leadership of the Philippines in global climate action and advocacy. The United Nations Office for Disaster Risk Reduction, or the UNISDR, has hailed our climate resilience laws as among the world's best. And I'm referring to the NGMC Law and the Climate Change Act. Philippine Climate Change Law, which I authored, created the Climate Change Commission, headed by no less than the President of the Republic of the Philippines, and it mainstreams climate change adaptation in various phases of policy formulation, with a national action plan and the local action plan, which all 1,634 cities and municipalities and 82 provinces must have by now. I admit it is not yet implemented in all local government units. Again, the original bill, which I wrote in 2007, had the funding mechanism. But as you know, those who are parliamentarians would understand that along the way, some non-believers in BRR and climate etched out the funding mechanism. And so, legislation is a child of compromise, we agreed, and there was no funding, and the People's Survival Fund had to be filed eventually after the first law was passed. But the good news is, it has been passed into law, the People's Survival Fund Act, a measure which I sponsored in the Philippine Senate, complements, which is actually a part of the original bill which I wrote in 2007. It helps by achieving its objectives through the provision of funds to local governments and people's organizations and non-government organizations and communities for their climate change adaptation programs. Again, the implementing rules and regulations, and I call on the Office of the President to sign it so that the rollout, which is done proactively by the PSF, and we have one of the members of the board here, Ren Constantino, and ASEC Joy Goffo is also present, can actually take into effect. Again, this PSF was newly enacted, again, because not everybody understands the importance of climate, and not everybody has embraced DRR as their life work, not many support the fact that it should be funded. But then, because legislation is all about compromise sometimes, we agreed before that it would be in the unbroken fund. Fast forward years later, it is now in the program fund, and it is the first time that there's a female chair of the finance committee who understands DRR, who has embraced CCA and DRR as her life advocacy, and now we have 1 billion in program fund, perhaps even more, for the People's Survival Fund. So from 2007 to 2015, it must take so long. But that is the importance of persistence. And never think that you can't get anything done, because compromises may be made along the way, but in the end, you will get what you want, as long as you know what you're doing is for the good of humanity. So this PSF supports the improvement of the monitoring, the controlling, the prevention of diseases triggered by climate change, the establishment of forecasting and early warning systems, the strengthening of institutional development for local governments, for preventive measures, planning, preparedness, the management of impacts relating to climate change. Many programs and projects for which the internal revenue allotment of local government units, for which people's organizations may have the capacity but don't have the capital, will be made available through the People's Survival Fund. Perhaps, again, our Department of Foreign Affairs, through UNIO, through Ambassador Rebong in Geneva, through our ambassador in Berlin, and in many other countries, developed nations, can perhaps tap assistance, technical and financial, for the CCCOM and for the PSF, so that we will have more funds apart from those allocated from the General Appropriations Act. Meanwhile, the Philippine National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Act promotes a comprehensive National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Plan that strengthens the capacity of the national government and the local government units together with partner stakeholders to build the disaster resilience of communities. And that is the one headed by Undersecretary Pama of the OCP present here today. Our government has also started climate tagging expenditure for climate change adaptation and mitigation, and will prioritize funding for adaptation to reduce the vulnerability and address the climate risks to our communities. The former Vice Chair, Commissioner Lucille Sereno, was running for Congress. I'm happy that I will have someone in the lower house to help me in CCA and DRR. But when she was still Vice Chair, she told me in our hearing a few weeks ago that there was at least 142 million in the 3.002 trillion peso budget, or a certain percentage of our funds allocated to climate. I was not happy about that, and I said, perhaps, Lucille, we could increase and make sure that more of the agency's budget could be climate tagged. In fact, I was not even certain whether the 142 is an accurate joy, is actually climate tagging, because she said, in fact, there were certain templates that needed to be followed, and agencies submitted their compliance with climate tagging. So what I did, after hearing that from Secretary Sereng, was to actually urge agencies to increase their adaptation and mitigation projects and programs and activities so that, in effect, the whole 3 trillion budget will be a climate budget. The whole 3 trillion budget will be DRR budget. We must integrate and mainstream so that in the construction of school buildings, geohazard maps must be used as basis. Multi-hazard risk assessments should have been conducted. There should be planning and engineering based on the strongest typhoon, Yolanda, which is 315 kilometers per hour. There should be wind velocity that should be taken into consideration. And old laws like the 1981 water catchment law should be integrated in infrastructure of government so that rainwater, which is frequent, which we have a lot of in this country, could be used for other purposes, of course, other than potable drinking water. What I'm saying is that mainstreaming of disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation in our 3 trillion budget is possible when feasible, and it actually should be prioritized. The Philippines is considered, or is consistent, in practicing leadership by example. In our INDC, we demonstrated that even vulnerable countries can plan, design, and implement ambitious climate adaptation and mitigation commitments. The Philippine government has also taken an active role in the CDF, initiating the establishment of the Vulnerable 20 Group of Ministers, or the V20. We've also committed to hosting the future South-South Center of Excellence on Climate Information and Services. The project, a joint undertaking of the Climate Change Commission and the PAGASA, which is the Weather Bureau under the Department of Science and Technology. It aims to facilitate collaboration on climate information and services by key actors in the country and globally through the Climate Vulnerable Forum by providing a venue for knowledge exchange and learning among countries vulnerable to climate change. Also, former Secretary Sering had mentioned to me that the GIZ, Dr. Rees is present here today, thank you for that, the German government agency will be assisting the Philippines in terms of financial and technical assistance in setting up the first climate center in Clark Green City, and we will be having training of LGUs. I'm also instructing the local government academy of the DILG, or the local government department, so that all local governments will have knowledge and training on disaster risk reduction. In all of this, we want to tell the world that we may be vulnerable, but we are not incapable of action. We should stop acting like victims. We should be more proactive and actually tell the world that we are capable of action. In closing, I thank all the countries, agencies, individuals, and guests who have made this gathering happen. Everyone's role is important, because the outcome of this meeting will be used for the CDF high level at COP21 in December. I would also like to take this opportunity to invite other vulnerable nations to join the CDF as members. And we ask the developed countries to support us and back us up. It is no longer to each his own philosophy, and not only a matter of economy or policy. It is an issue of humanity and of conscience. We live in only one planet, that's for sure, and that's so simply said. And by now, climate change should make countries, developed or developing, realize that moats, gates, massive barriers, borders are ephemeral, easily destroyed, and antiquated concepts. The truth is, there are really no borders. We are all connected, and we suffer the consequences of climate change altogether. We suffer the consequences of the abuse on the environment. We suffer the consequences of apathy, of ignorance, of bureaucratic red tape. We suffer the consequences of the abuses of the developed nations who do not comply with their commitments to financial and technical assistance to developing nations. This is not the time for restraint. This is not the time to wag the finger of indictment. This is the moment for a collective and urgent climate action. Thank you. Good morning, all.